Yeah, I'm kind of intrigued by the kind of symmetric or quasi-symmetric forms. Does that depend on finding language which happens to lend itself to that, or?
You're saying in the compositions that are symmetrical?
Yes, like the very first one you had on there.
Oh, the ikra.
Yes, the ikra.
Yeah.
And there were many other examples
yeah.
which were
All right.
fully or partially
yes.
symmetrical. So does that, is it often done with any, you know, verse, or does it depend on finding, you know, a sentence or a verse which is already, you know, which happens to be written in a way which can be more easily rendered in a symmetrical design like this?
So this is actually what we call a muthanna, which is a mirror image. And we do not do this freehand. This is important for many students try this freehand, you know, they're very frustrated. This is also done with a stencil to be able to create the perfect mirror image. And there are no, I mean, it is done with, even with the name of God, there is the muthanna. And it actually has a lot of symbolism, you know.
So this, in fact,
this is ikra, this is aleph, kaf, ra, aleph, and then aleph, kaf, ra, aleph.
So it's just a repetition
the same,
of, the,
yeah.
of the first one. Right?
It's a mirror image. It's basically the one piece which is then flipped over and superposed like this.
But there are other examples which are not mirror images.
There are other examples which are not mirror images. So the genius of the calligrapher is to choose a good verse that allows you to find this rhythm, to find similar shapes. That's why you have certain verses that are written a lot by calligraphers because they're very nice. You know, you have like the very nice chanaks coming one after the other and so on. But then it's also the genius of the calligrapher to make a verse which is not very easy to make it look very harmonious. You know, that's also where you find the different levels of form.
So would you say that the harmony that is
students who are actually also studying recitation, so they always tell me there are so many parallels in both arts.
How much Arabic do you need to know before you start this?
Well, not very much, because you can learn it as you go along. So I have a lot of students who don't know any Arabic. My Arabic is not very high level. I had to learn Turkish very well to talk to my teachers, but so it is very good to know Arabic, of course, but it's not a condition, and you can learn it as you go along. Because actually, sometimes when you don't know any Arabic, it helps because you just see the abstract shape of the stroke. I have some Arabic speakers who are so determined by what they've seen throughout their life, you know, that they do the ba the way they've always seen it. And I have to say, just forget everything and just do one stroke, two strokes, you see? So it goes both ways. But obviously, knowing the language is always
I was just intrigued by what you said with regard to the layers that come up and
yes.
move forward. And I've been studying classical drawing, classical painting with a Russian teacher.
Uh-huh.
So one of the things that she always says is that forget about the fact that you're drawing an eye or an ear or a mouth.
Exactly.
Concentrate on the line.